The Development Impact Assessment Framework was designed to enable identification, understanding, and communication of links between LEDs and NDC actions and development priorities to facilitate decision-making. Development Impact Assessment provides a structured approach to consider impacts across sectors of the economy and can be supported by either or both qualitative and quantitative information. This is a key element in a number of countries that may face data constraints. DIA also allows for exploration of linkages across development priorities as well as trade-offs and provides a basis to compare LEDs options. Importantly, DIA supports clear communication of development impacts to inform high-level LEDs decision-making and investments. Finally, DIA supports identification of key actions or impacts that may require further analysis to inform LEDs planning. Provides structured approach to consider impacts across sectors. Supports representation of qualitative as well as quantitative information. Explores linkages across development priorities and trade-offs. Facilitates comparability among technology options. Provides a mechanism to clearly communicate development impacts. Helps identify key actions and impacts for further study. It is important to note that development impact assessment can support both planning and implementation of LEDs actions. For instance, DIA can feed into a broader low-emission development strategy to inform prioritization of mitigation actions at a high level. At the same time, DIA can support investments on the ground through assessing development impacts of a small subset of potential projects planned for implementation. Historically, many countries have used marginal abatement cost, or MAC curves, as a key element of LEDs analysis. MAC curves provide a relatively simple approach to compare mitigation impacts and costs of actions to support low-emission development pathways. Each of the bars in a MAC curve represents a mitigation action. For each action, the width of the bar represents the abatement potential as compared to business as usual, and the height of the bar represents the abatement cost as compared to business as usual. Each of the individual bars or actions are often arranged from least cost, which is often negative or below the x-axis, to highest cost. While the MAC curve is widely used and provides a relatively straightforward approach to compare mitigation options, it does not reflect development impacts associated with LEDs options. Further, it should be noted that MAC curves can also present challenges related to characterization of uncertainty, intertemporal conditions, and transparency of assumptions. However, these issues are not elaborated in this training course. The Development Impact Assessment Framework seeks to build on the popularity, simplicity, and valuable information captured in the MAC curve by adding another dimension to assess development impacts of LEDs actions. To do this, the framework essentially flips the MAC curve on its side, putting the lowest cost options on the top and the highest cost options on the bottom of the MAC curve. The framework then integrates a number of columns for specific development impacts. These columns allow development impact scores to be presented for each LEDs option, building on the abatement potential and cost information. In the example framework presented on this slide, development impacts of technology options can be scored as positive, with a half green circle, high positive, with a full green circle, negative, with a half red circle, or neutral, with a bar. However, users can tailor this scoring methodology to align with specific country circumstances, as will be detailed in coming slides. Within this framework, either qualitative or quantitative information and analysis can be used to inform individual impact scores. The framework intentionally allows for this flexibility in relation to potential data constraints in different country contexts. As you will see in the case studies, qualitative approaches have been commonly used to populate the development impact element of the framework. However, rigorous quantitative assessments can also inform the scoring process. It is critical for users of the visual to comprehensively annotate each cell with either qualitative or quantitative information to inform the score. This slide zooms in on the MAC curve element of the DIA framework and shows that the MAC curve remains unchanged. Building on the MAC curve by providing columns to present key development impacts of technology options, the framework simply adds another component to support development-focused climate decision-making. While the MAC curve is useful in giving a sense of marginal cost and abatement potential, it should be noted that use of the MAC curve within the framework is not required. As will be seen in upcoming slides, for most country applications to date, the MAC curve has, in fact, been excluded. As noted, the framework allows for great flexibility and adaptability in relation to scoring of development impacts associated with LEDs options. Users of the tool should develop clear and detailed information on the scoring methodology used and provide annotations with sources of analysis, data, and/or expert opinion to justify scores provided. Users can tailor the scoring framework. For instance, in Zambia, which we will discuss in a moment, stakeholders design the framework to include only positive, neutral, and negative scores, and excluded high positive. In this circumstance, stakeholders found it difficult to differentiate and support, with a high degree of confidence, a positive score versus a high positive score. Users should be careful to design the framework in a way that is unbiased and provides clear justifications for scoring various actions. This slide zooms in on the impact categories included in the framework. Users of the framework can adapt the tool to focus on specific impacts of most interest and aligned with the country's or jurisdiction's development goals. Common impacts included in the DIA framework are outlined in this slide. Social development impacts of most interest might include energy access, health, education, and gender, among others. Key economic impacts might include employment and local industry development and impacts on gross domestic product and trade. Finally, key environmental impacts, in addition to GHG mitigation, might include water use, biodiversity, and climate resilience. Again, as noted in the previous slide, countries can choose impacts for assessment based on key national or subnational development goals. This slide shows a view of the framework if a user decided to focus on a subset of LEDs actions for comparison. In many cases where the framework has been applied, users have focused comparison of actions at the sectoral level and have thus created separate frameworks for each sector. However, one key benefit of the framework is that it allows for comparison of actions across sectors, providing a comprehensive view of abatement potential, costs, and development impacts of potential actions.